Well, hello. Thank you for watching us this evening. Thank you for watching Checkpoints on Urban TV. I am Jackie Achan, your host, and with us tonight, we have two guests, both executive directors working with persons with disability. With us tonight, we have Apollo Mukasa. He is the executive director of the Uganda National Action on Physical Disability. And we have Betty Cheptoyek. She is the executive director, Show Abilities Uganda. Now, on the show tonight, we want to discuss issues of persons with disability. We know Uganda has always been praised about having the best laws when it comes to persons with disability, but when it comes to the implementation of these laws, there have always been questions because we've seen persons with disability are still struggling in the country, whether they are perhaps school-going children or persons who are working, they have to go to work. We have seen that there have always been issues around their plight. So tonight we want Mr. Mukasa and Betty Cheptoyek to, take us through what is in this country in terms of the laws on persons with disability and how they are being implemented and if they're working in the country. So welcome to the show, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you.
So you've had my introduction talking about the laws about persons of, with disability in the country. Are you happy with the laws that we have in the country when it comes to persons with disability? Let's start with Mr. Mukasa.
Yeah, thank you, Jackie. As you say, my name is Mukasa Apollo. I'm the executive director for Uganda National Action on Physical Disability. But also I sit on the National Building Review Board, which is a board, a government agency, which is responsible, mandated to monitor the building constructions in Uganda. And I sit on that board basically to represent the interests of persons with disabilities. In line with your question, Jackie, yes, as you mentioned it clearly, that Uganda is always classified or praised to have a very good legal framework when it comes to persons with disabilities. And the parliament and the government has done a lot of work to ensure these policies are there. Policies which highlight our rights as persons with disabilities, policies which mandates inclusive service provisions to ensure that everyone accesses services, including persons with disabilities. And policies are quite a number of them. And if to mention a few, which we really know in our disability sector, since you're here to talk about disability, we've got our mother law, which is like we call the Persons with Disabilities Act, which was first developed in 2006, but that just been amended by the parliament in 2020, which is a government legal framework, which spells out our rights as persons with disabilities. But also we have the UNCRPD, that's international law, that is UN Convention on Rights of Persons with Disabilities, which was ratified by UN countries in 2006, and Uganda signed in 2008. Those two are pillars of the laws, but of course you have other legal framework like Persons with Disabilities Policy, which is also under review, and other legal frameworks. But also outstandingly, also have a law called the Building Control Act, which is a government law as well. This law is basically monitors building constructions. The issues that our building are constructed. As you see, we have a very fertile building industry. Buildings are cropping up each and every day. But the question is, to what extent are those buildings, are we able to access them by persons with disabilities? If I'm using a wheelchair like my sister Betty, if I'm using crutch like a Kemia, am I able to access a studio, am I able to access a flat, a building, a school, an hospital with ease, without being difficult, without being assisted, without being dehumanized, without being, you get my point, independently. So that's where we are. But come to use, yes, laws are there, but there's implementation. That's a fact. Less implementation is simply because that one, less prioritization is still being given to this sector. Much the government has tried to put in place laws, but there's less prioritization when it comes to issues of persons with disabilities. We need to see that how do we bring out these laws to be known to the people? How do people know about these laws we have in the country? People know about the Disabilities Act, then about it, then about the Building Control Act, then about the inconvenience of persons with disabilities. Are these laws known? Mm. Even us as persons, we know about these laws, that they protect our rights. So that's why there's less of implementation. That there's limited awareness about these laws, but also prioritization by the government to put in place these laws to make them into practice is still not yet the level you think you want them.
Maybe Betty can expound for us why there is limited awareness about these laws. And he talks about like the Persons with Disability Act was just amended 2020. That means they saw some shortcomings and they decided to amend. 2020 is not so far,
so far away.
So why do we see these shortcomings still up to date?
Thank you very much, Jackie. My name is Betty Cheptoek. I'm the Executive Director, Show Abilities Uganda, which is an umbrella organization that is led by the youth and for the youth with different disability categories. Regarding the question you've asked me, why are these laws probably not implemented in the country? I think, to me, like my brother has expounded, that we have very good laws in this country. And the challenge for me, I think, is the will by the leadership probably, and also the interest in the area. Like he has said, priority. They would prioritize other areas, other policies, but when it comes to these ones of persons with disabilities, there is no much support by the leaders, the political leaders. Say, for example, in one of the districts, I'll not mention the name, when it comes to, for example, passing or pushing for budgets that are going to support the implementation of some of these disability-related activities, you realize that the council has very small interest. Each time you, like, people try to talk about anything related to disability, most people will always want to to cover it up and then rush to other things. And I think for me, if the mindset of the leadership, the mindset of the decision makers really come to appreciate the fact that, yes, we have persons with disabilities who are members of parliament. If we can work with these persons with disabilities, members of parliament, and then the leadership of the disability fraternity within this country, then they will get to know the challenges, the issues that are affecting persons with disabilities, and in the long run, they will learn to appreciate that. I think we need to implement or put these policies into enforcement. So, but I think it still has to take a gradual process before we can reach there.
What would that process look like, the gradual process?
Of course, the gradual process, we need to do a lot of sensitization to make people understand really the needs of persons with disabilities regarding to accessibility. Because accessibility is a broader issue and it affects all categories of persons with disabilities. And if you look at the statistics of 12.4%, it's a big, big number, which I think it is just something that we need to appreciate and say that this is not a small number and we need to see how to address their challenges. So for me, that's what I really think.
12.4%, that is the number of persons with disability,
yes,
in the country. So yeah. What would you think would be the right approach in you know, working together? Because like she explained, there is some sort of a disconnect. Mm-hmm. The leaders don't feel the need and the urgency to address the issues of persons with disability.
Yeah, the one of the most practical ways of working together, Jackie, you know that the disability movement is broad. We have quite a number of different organizations of persons with disabilities. I represent United for Persons with Physical, she represents for the youth. There are those for the blind, the deaf blind, the cerebral palsy, so there are quite a number of them. And if, first of all, we come together, we as the movement, and advance a joint cause, that as persons with disabilities, maybe this time, maybe this financial year or this year, we want to focus ourselves on issues of accessibility, for instance. And all our efforts are driven towards that. Whatever resources you've got, whatever human resource you've got, efforts you've got, airtime you've got on TV or radios, we are advancing the cause for maybe for accessibility. That is our agenda for a particular year. Then that means you're able to engage everybody concerned in that. You're able to engage MPs, able to get live ministries, able to engage even ourselves, the persons with disability, to understand our rights. That can make us to move in a very streamed way. But at times what happens is that if we don't organize new advocacy campaigns, I'm handling this, the other one is handling the other, and the other one is handling the other ones. At the end of the day, almost all of you end halfway through the way. Don't reach a conclusive end where you want to be. So I think combined efforts is one way that I need to see how we organize ourselves in a combined way to focus on one agenda, for instance, on a particular period, that we focus on this particular period and want to see this one reaching a particular target. Then maybe progressively I can also, another time you can also target something else like that. But also the other way is that to understand this legal framework, just as Beta has mentioned, we need to understand these laws. I'm telling you, Jackie, that most times me, when I do advocacy, I try to refer to the lawyers. You know, people who have done law, that they really understand the law. That's not because they have studied law, but because they have the passion for what they have studied. And those who understand law, they make use of it. You have seen cases whereby someone can just come and give you and slaps you, Jackie, and slaps you an assault, and you get a lawyer and sue me, and I pay you millions of Ghanaians. But for us, even when someone slaps me, even when I slide on the building and get a secondary disability, we go on grumbling, we go on complaining, this building is not accessible, this person have done A, B, and C. We don't take a step to say, I've slid from a building owned by who? Why have I slid? I've got a skin disability. Can I take a legal action against this person? We don't have that courtesy. We just keep quiet. We just go on grumbling. Just keep on complaining. And even the society takes us, those ones will end there. They don't do much. You get my point? So we need to get out of that zone. And we become like real advocates. You know what we are supposed to be entitled to. And we use the laws we have in the country to push them. To make an example. For me, I think making an example is we need to test the law. You have not tested the law in the disability sector. And that's one way I think we need to move forward. That people can understand that also is a person in disability can take you to court. Can do something very, 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 very strategic. Because you stop looking at us as people who think that we're always there to always talk about something and leave it there. We talk about something and enforce it and take it to another step. That way, I think, will be felt.
So you're saying there's not been any action taken by any person with disability when they've come in a difficult situation that has resulted from maybe the people in charge not implementing what is supposed to be implemented to aid perhaps, let's say, for a person with physical disability, maybe movement in a building. I go to a building, I slide, and then I break something in my body, and then no action is taken. We haven't had such cases?
We have not had systematic efforts towards that. What I can say, we are organized as a movement, but we have not get organized well to tackle an agenda in a very straight way. We are a number of disabled organizations, as I mentioned, but if I say that maybe we have a systematic advocacy strategy, that this period, let's handle this. As all of us, whether I'm blind, I'm deaf, I'm physical, I'm deaf blind, let's handle this, because we all have the same problems. I think whether we can move somewhere. In line with the taking a legal effort, a legal action towards someone, I think in the disability sector, we've not done so much in that. We are more into raising awareness. We are more into empowering people. We're more into building the capacity. Some efforts have been done to take legal action, but they have not reached somewhere. They have not reached a level whereby someone can really feel the need to make a place, for instance, accessible to persons with disability, because tomorrow I may be sold.
Is it as a result of being resigned to fate? Like, you know, even if I tried, it won't work.
It's not that you are resigned to fate, that even if I try, it won't work. It's about we are still lacking self-belief into ourselves. To give a trial. Maybe Beth can also add one.
sorry. I think also it is because persons with disabilities may not be aware of this right, that it's a right rather than a privilege. And so because of that and the low self-esteem that people still have, they fear to come out. Then some of the people who have had experiences, for example, they've gone to access a service and they've been denied, or they have reached where they were supposed to access this service and they are unable to find the people who are supposed to, who they are supposed to speak to. For example, you've gone to see, let me use, I don't want to use police, let me use another service. But you find that where you are supposed to access a service, maybe the decision maker is upstairs and they are not probably willing to attend to you. And then, or others have gone and then they are told, but for you, I have seen this severally with those who are, want to access justice in regards to sexual reproductive health and rights issues. When they reach there, they are reminded that, but you know, you don't need, even by police, they say, you know, for you, you have a disability. This person just helped you. You don't need even to pursue this person. But I know that the problem I have is this person has violated my right, has left me with a responsibility. He doesn't want to take care of, for example, the child or the children. And then you go there, these people just like play around you, and then you lose interest. Because you know that even if I went there, nobody is going to attend to you. But again, when you look at persons without disabilities, when they have such issues, they can follow up, and you see other legal service aid service providers coming to support them, to air out their issues. But there is a very limited interest for persons with disabilities. That one, I bet you. Mm-hmm. I have not seen any cases of persons with disabilities that someone has brought out an issue, maybe of accessibility of a building, and then different lawyers are coming together to back up this person to push this. If that one was there, or two of them in this country, I think what we would be talking now would be history.
Mr. Mukasa, I know you mentioned you represent persons with a physical disability. Mm. I want you to give us an example of maybe something that has happened that you feel has been the biggest injustice to persons with disability in this country.
Injustice in line with?
Physical disability.
Physical disability.
Yes.
Yeah, thank you for that. The fact that I come from the fraternity of person with physical disability, the injustice you can cause to a person with physical disability is inability to access the very key service. Betty has mentioned about sexual reproductive health. If at all I'm a woman with disability and I've gone to seek sexual and reproductive health services in the health center, as a woman with disability, I'm using crutches, I'm using a wheelchair. And honestly speaking, I cannot access this facility because it's not accessible. How do you expect me to be supported? You're denying me a very pertinent service because your structure, you put it in such a way that it's welcome to others, but it's not welcome to me. And I can only seek that service because of my physical disability. To me, the injustice of not being able to access services, like anybody else who is not a person with disability, is the greatest injustice I can see. Because when you give out services, you're offering education, you're offering all services, and for all, and you're calling us, everybody's welcome to come. But upon I come with my crutches and I find the human resource manager is upstairs, I don't even attend the interview. Full of steps, I cannot go there, but I'm here as an individual. My qualifications, with my capability, with my experience, and I cannot even access human resource manager to seek for employment like anybody else. Then why are you pressing me? You're denying me access to a service which is entitled to everyone, including us. To me, that is the greatest injustice I can see. The inability to access a service because of the physical environment or lack of reasonable accommodation to get a person with disabilities, and you hear saying services are for all, which is necessarily not true. We are carrying an environment injustice.
So how do we start to change that? We've seen the problems. Let's now talk about the solutions. Where does it start from?
The solutions?
Yes.
The solutions, as we have been saying, we've been trying to highlight here, is one, is to raise awareness about the marks we have in the country. Because we as advocacy organizations, we're based on a legal framework, which the government put in place. We don't even put in place legal frameworks, but the government and the parliament put in place laws, which guides service delivery, which guides whatever service you're offering. Mm. But the challenge we have is that there is limited awareness about these laws we have in the country. Mm. When it counts persons with disabilities per se, we need to bring all these laws so that they are known by our constituency. That if it's about accessing health, what are the laws about accessing health? It's about accessing education, what does it say? It's about accessing employment, what does it say? That people can know about this. Even you are giving services, well, so that you know, if I'm employing a person with disability in this TV, like Urban TV, what am I supposed to be doing? Mm. To employ Apollo, to employ Betty. Mm. What things do I have to put in place? For reasonable accommodation. That when I come here, work here, I work with comfort. I don't work as if I'm too vulnerable. And look at me with pity, that hey, Apollo is here, works here, give him what. You look at me with pity. Even you reduce the confidence I have in myself because everybody says, sorry, because you have that. You think, look at us with pity. Mm. But an environment is conducive to everyone. Mm. That me and you and Betty and Jackie, I can work together in the same environment with the same capabilities, with the same skills. My difference between me and you is just an impairment. Mm. But the rest, I can perform. Mm. That, I think we need to do that. That's what, secondly, also we ourselves need to be able to be empowered to limit the self-esteem, like the low self-esteem we have. Mm. To know that despite my disability, I can do anything like Jack can do it. Mm. I can go to a studio and do a program. I can be a teacher. I can be a professor. I can be a nurse. I can be a doctor. Mm. I can be a resource manager. Mm. Despite my disability. That low self-esteem we still have within our members is also limiting us to advance to another level. That's also another step we need to do to build our self-esteem, raise awareness about our person's disability. You have potential, you have the ability, you have a talent. Mm. Many of us have talents. We have potentials. Betty is a director of an organization. People have seen many of us being employed even in other mainstream sectors. TVs, radios. I've not seen a journalist with disability in a TV or radio program, but I studied journalism. Or should I have been in Urban? I've seen my OBs here. And you say, ah, Paula, why? For us, you're here. Say, so, you are here, I'm not here. Mm. But we start to get that my career is journalism. Wow. Well, I've seen that at least you find a journalist with a person with disability doing journalism in Urban TV or in Bukedi. On a camera. Mm. But there's that gap. There's that gap that, how are you able to handle the camera? How are you able to do that? How are you able to do that? How do you access the studio? Then you tell us, you may not have enough space here. So those are issues. We need to change the perception of people, perception of personal disabilities, but also the perception of other people surrounding us, that we see how can we move to another level.
Betty, you agree with Mr. Mukasa?
I agree with him 100%. Yes, and I want to add that I think the environment is the one that also disables us the more. Mm. Because, for example, you're growing up with your challenges with disability, but that kind of the pity environment, because the environment is not accessible friendly, I mean disability friendly, maybe you were walking and then you missed a step and then you slid. Now people will come and start telling you, oh sorry, but why did you even come here? But those are the things, those small words are the ones that turn us off. And sometimes now you are fallen and it becomes an attention to everybody, and then you feel very small. Then the other thing I think that needs to be done is, when these policies are passed, the first people that need to be sensitized, trained to understand these policies, are the people at the grassroots. And I mean people like the DCDOs, the chairpersons of districts, the cows of districts, those key people, the RDCs, so that by the time it reaches persons with disabilities, the leaders, the people who are implementing these policies at those levels are able to relay the information to persons with disabilities, so that by the time the disability movement is going there, which is supplementing on the work of government, it is actually doing most of the secondary work, because then the government has done its part of passing policies, and then also has done the role of enforcing them by training and building capacities of the leadership, the disability fraternity within those districts all over the country. And then it makes work much more easier for persons with disabilities to sail through, because information is power and ignorance is one of the biggest, greatest challenges that has made many people fail to understand the direction where they should take. And for me, we have very good policies. I appreciate this country, but the challenge, as we have said from the start, is enforcement. And the enforcement cannot only happen at national level. When we come here and sit in these conference halls at national level, we are in Africana, we are the people who need these services, are those in the villages, are those ones at the districts, because then how will the counselor, persons with disabilities, or counselors, or the disability council be empowered to speak on behalf of those people they interact with on a daily basis? For me, I think empowerment is key. To persons with disabilities, and then two, sensitizing the leadership who are handling these people on a daily life at grassroots level would be, for me, very important before we even speak about other issues outside there.
Jackie, to add on something,
right.
As I said earlier on, I sit on the board called the National Building Review Board.
Mm.
And that board is a government agency, but its mandate is to ensure that the building industry is designed in such a way which is safe and usable. But my role there is to ensure that the building is being put up in the country of Uganda, the accessible persons with disabilities.
Mm.
And that's my mandate on that board.
Mm.
And the time I've been that board, we have tried to see that our buildings should be accessible to persons with disabilities. One of the strategies we want to employ to do, actually my organization does, because I'm here in two capacities, I'm a director of United, but also I sit on that board.
Mm.
We do what you call accessibility auditing of buildings. With accessibility auditing of buildings, you can come here to this Urban TV and I audit you to assess whether Urban is accessible or not accessible. When Urban TV is not accessible, I give recommendations that to make Urban TV accessible, you must do the following.
Mm.
If that campaign is done wider, ask to audit most of the buildings, we call it bureau offices, call it government agencies or private sector, and the owners of those buildings comply to the recommendations of accessibility as put within the law, I think we begin to see a very inclusive, accessible environment in the near future. Because the law is very clear. The Building Control Act is very clear on issues of accessibility. The PWS Act is very clear on to that. Even the UNCRPD, the UN Convention, Right to Persons with Disabilities, is very clear on to that. But we need to enforce those laws. How are they enforced? To see that even us, we enjoy the environment we work within.
Mm.
One of the challenges why we are left behind is because of an accessible environment, inaccessible building structures. We come to seek for employment. You cannot enter a company's premises when I'm using a wheelchair, if I'm using crutches, and it gets stranded on doing along the way, because the company structure was put in such a way there are only steps. They think anybody can climb steps.
Mm-hmm.
I've got a job here and I cannot even access the urinals, because I'm a being, I have to go there. I've got a job here and I cannot even access the receptionist. You get my point?
Right.
All those issues drive us away. Even the employers, even the provider of services will get scared and say, if I bring Apollo here, how will I cater for the following? And say, don't bring him.
Okay.
Let him remain where he is. When you bring me, bring us problems. They will say, you bring us problems.
Right.
So become a problem. Why you have the excuse of adding value to the company, to the organization, to the sector, when you come to add value, they will say, I will bring you problems. Because the environment today is created in such a way that I cannot comfortably work within it, exercise my rights, my potentials, like you do.
Well, let's hold it there. We'll take a short commercial break. When we come back, we'll continue with the discussion.